Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
And may the people of God say amen.
Amen.
Amen. I am truly humbled this afternoon to have the privilege and the honor to stand before you. And in so many ways for me, this is a homecoming. Some of the most formative years of my life were spent here in the great city of Richmond, growing, learning, being nurtured by marvelous mentors such as none other than the pastor of this illustrious church, the Reverend Dr. James Henry Harris, and also being one of the members of the last class of homiletics that would be taught by the Reverend Dr. Miles Jerome Jones. One of my first experiences here in the city was during a time in which many of the pastors from my native North Carolina were completing their doctoral ministry at the School of Theology. And during that time, I came to know and love the city of Richmond in such a way that I felt I needed my GPS once I was on 95, but it did not take long before it felt as if I had never left. And so I thank you for allowing me the privilege to not only stand before you today, but also to return to Second Baptist from this wonderful pulpit from which I preached many years ago when I was not even yet ordained. And so to have the opportunity to stand before you this afternoon is nothing that I take lightly in any way. I also bring you greetings from Peter's Tabernacle Missionary Baptist Church in Wallace, North Carolina, which is located in what we call the Iron Mine Community. And so certainly the wonderful parishioners and the brothers and sisters in Christ who have allowed me to serve as their pastor also send their greetings, and they send their love to you as well. I'm going to just test this for a moment. Wonderful. So I have been given the privilege this afternoon in honor of Drs. Lewis Hill and Brown, in honor of all three of their pastorates, to discuss briefly the Black religious tradition in America and the world. This is my area of specialization to which I've dedicated the past two decades of my life to studying. And I want to simply begin here with some of the core readings that I have found over the course of the last two decades, that if someone were to ask me, where does one start in studying the incontrovertible importance of Black religion in America and in the American tradition, I certainly would recommend that as a very definitive starting point, The Souls of Black Folk by Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois. But also, even more recently in 2015, the publication of Dr. Sylvester Johnson, The African American Religions 1500 to 2000, Colonialism, Democracy, and Freedom, is one of the more recent all-encompassing works that's written very much in the tradition of scholars such as Dr. John Hope Franklin, and that it accounts for all of Black religion, and not only all of Black religion in America, but all of Black Atlantic religion. We also have here Dr. Joseph Surrett, Black as a Church. Again, this is a very recent publication, 2023, and his thesis is quite important in that he discusses what it means to be Black, not only in America, but in the world in light of history. And that there is an idiom, there is a culture, there is a tradition that transcends denominationalism, transcends any one particular religious tradition, that Blackness itself is a church. And this is a wonderful companion piece to the 2020 publication, Black Suffering, Silent Pain, Hidden Hope. I think we all recognize this remarkable scholar here who produced this work. What is so important about Black suffering, an area of study of mine is called theodicy. And the word theodicy comes from two Greek words, theos meaning God and dike meaning justification. Theodicy poses the question, how do we explain evil and sin and suffering in a world that is created by an all-powerful, all-knowing, all-loving God? And theodicy answers that question. But the theodical predicament must be specified in terms of the lives, the traditions of Black people, because Black suffering is unique in human history. It is unique in the human present. and that there are certain elements and dimensions of suffering as a black person that are not comparative to the European tradition. They're not comparative to any other tradition. There's a uniqueness in it. But also that uniqueness, I have found, can be identified and located within the gospel itself. The more that I read the gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the more I am confounded as to how anyone can read the gospels and not see the black experience in all 16 chapters of Mark, and all 28 chapters of Matthew, and all 24 chapters of Luke, and in all 21 chapters of John's gospel. I am confused as to how anyone cannot understand that it's the story of a group of people living in a world during a time of imperial domination. And that there are people who do not look like the people who control the taxes, the revenue, and the politics of the area. And yet they are so loved by God that they are placed above the empires and the structures of the world. And that God chooses the people who the world says are not worthy of love and says, I will make them first, the last shall be first. I am confused as to how anyone can read the gospel and not see from the beginning to the end in each and every line. And as Dr. Miles Jones used to say, there's more power in a comma in the gospel than all the other words in all the other books that have ever been written. And so both of these words, for me, help to situate who we are in the world in relationship to God and in relationship to living our lives. In terms of the historical argument as to how we discuss blackness, it has primarily come to this divide that we find here. On the left, we have Dr. E. Franklin Frazier, a sociologist who wrote The Negro Family in the United States in 1939. And here we have Dr. Melville Herskovitz, an anthropologist, who wrote The Myth of the Negro Mask in 1941. And the argument essentially fell in these two camps. Dr. Frazier argued that the quote-unquote, and I'm going to say quote-unquote Negro in America, and by the end of this presentation, you will understand why I think the word Negro historically should be placed in quotations. He argued that the Negro in America is an American without a particular cultural connection to the continent of Africa, and thus should be evaluated in relationship to other Americans. Whereas Melville Herskovitz decided to move to South Africa, he lived on the continent for a number of years and ultimately produced work in which he argued that it would be impossible for any human being on Earth to say that they had no connection to the continent, seeing as how the earliest human beings to ever walk the Earth walked on the continent of Africa. But furthermore, that what he argues, what America calls the Negro in America, but in fact, the descendants of Africans in America are just that, the descendants of the continent of Africa in America.
Could you just tell us where E. Franklin Frazier was professor, so people will know?
If I'm correct, Columbia University.
But first at Howard.
Yes, but first at Howard University and then Columbia University.
Right.
And if I'm also correct, he was the uncle of Dr. Samuel Roberts.
Right.
Yes, as well, who served both Virginia Union and Union Presbyterian Seminary. Dr. Frazier was also a member of Abyssinian Baptist Church in Harlem, and famously befriended Dietrich Bonhoeffer, a German theologian who joined the Abyssinian for 1 year while he was studying at Union Theological Seminary. Speaking of Union Theological Seminary, we have here a great scholar, I'm sure if not known to all of us, known to most of us, the Reverend Dr. Katie Geneva Kent. While there are other scholars who are credited as being the pioneers and the founders of what we call womanist theology, I think very good arguments can be made that the most prominent amongst those voices still remains the Reverend Dr. Katie Geneva Kent.